Hi, this module is an introduction to deafness and hearing impairment and is part of a series of modules on deafness and hearing loss put together by the Sensory and Physical Support Team in Peterborough. You will learn how the ear works and the names for the different types of hearing loss. We'll take a look at an audiogram and see how we label the different levels of deafness onto this. And finally, we'll get a chance to do some activities to help you understand deafness and hearing impairment a little better. So, let's look at the ear and try and understand how hearing works. There are three parts to the ear: the outer ear, middle ear, and inner ear. Looking first at the outer ear, this is made up of the pinna, or the piece of skin attached to the side of our head, and the ear canal, basically the hole and tunnel into your ear. We then go to the second part of the ear, the middle ear, which consists of the tympanic membrane, or eardrum as we most commonly call it, and the three little ossicle bones. After this section of the ear, we move into the inner ear, which consists of the cochlea and auditory nerve. Take a quick look at the diagram and make sure you can see those parts to the ear. Now, let's consider the process of hearing. Sound waves enter through the pinna, that external piece of skin, into the ear canal. They hit the tympanic membrane or eardrum, which should cause this eardrum to vibrate, like the drum skin on the top of a drum. This then makes the bones, one of which is resting against the eardrum, vibrate. And this, in turn, passes the message on to the cochlea. The cochlea in the inner ear is lined with hair cells, which respond to the vibrations and convert those vibrations into electrical signals, which are then passed up to the auditory nerve and then to the brain. It's the brain, of course, which then has to make sense of this sound. It is remarkable that hearing involves so many processes that happen so quickly when the hearing pathway is working well. However, of course, the group we are focusing on have issues with this hearing pathway. So now let's look at where these issues can arise. There are three main types of hearing loss. The first type, conductive hearing loss, which can mean an obstruction in the ear canal or problems in the middle ear, including a condition that is very common and often called glue ear, where a thick fluid prevents the ossicles, or those three bones we just looked at, from vibrating optimally and sending any messages on to the inner ear. Often there are treatments which can help with conditions associated with conductive types of hearing loss. For example, you may have heard of children who have had a grommet operation or grommets inserted. Mostly this will be to deal with glue ear. The second type of hearing loss is sensory neural hearing loss. Most commonly, this means that there has been damage to the hair cells in the cochlea. The more damage to the hair cells, the greater the hearing loss will be. This is a permanent hearing loss, which can be present at birth or can happen through disease or trauma later in life. This sensory neural hearing loss, as we say, is often permanent. The third type or group of hearing loss is known as a mixed hearing loss, and is a combination of conductive and sensory neural hearing loss. So, for example, a child with a permanent mild sensory hearing loss may also get glue ear, which temporarily will mean that their hearing gets worse whilst the glue ear is present. If you work with a deaf learner, it is really important to find out what type of hearing loss they have, as this will influence hearing technology they get and What type of deafness they have had and for how long will also have implications for their communication and learning. Now we will go on to look at levels of deafness, as these can vary from person to person and can vary between the right and the left ear, which may not always have an identical hearing loss. On the next slide, you will see a pictorial representation of an audiogram showing the different levels of deafness or hearing impairment. If you look at the vertical axis, the one going up and down, this shows loudness in decibels, getting louder and louder as you go down towards the bottom of the diagram. If you look at the horizontal axis, the one going from side to side, this shows frequency or pitch in hertz, going from low frequencies on the left-hand side to higher frequencies or higher pitches on the right-hand side. Audiograms are used to plot what an individual can hear at the different levels of loudness and pitch. If you look again and focus on the green sort of boomerang-shaped shading on that picture, this is what's often called the speech banana, and it shows what loudness levels and what pitches make up the loudness and pitches of speech. For example, you'll see the letters M, S. M is a lower pitch sound. S are higher pitch sounds. So M is to the left. S are to the right. Alongside the audiogram, you can see the different levels of hearing loss. Normal hearing, mild hearing loss, moderate hearing loss, moderate to severe hearing loss, severe hearing loss, profound hearing loss. It can be seen that even with a mild hearing loss, 20 to 40 decibel hearing loss, there are some speech sounds that will be difficult for that individual to hear. Or F, or S, or TH, for example. When a person has a hearing loss, they rarely hear at the same level across the whole frequency range. In order to decide whether their hearing loss is mild, moderate, severe, or profound, an average is taken of 5 points across the frequency range to give an overall level. It is also important for you to know that a hearing loss can be unilateral in one ear only, or bilateral in both ears, and rarely is the loss absolutely identical in both ears. People often want to know what it sounds like to have a particular level of hearing loss. We recommend that you follow this link to hear hearing loss simulations and what it's like to listen with a mild, moderate, severe or profound hearing loss. This will only take you a minute or so and should give you a better understanding of the impact of hearing loss on following and understanding speech. Now it is your turn to have a go at seeing what you've learned so far. You may need to refer back to the audiogram picture to help you. To do the next activity, you also need to know that on an audiogram, the right ear results are shown as circles, often in red, and the left ear results as crosses, often in blue. Take your time, refer back, and have a go. We will be giving you the answers. Have a look at this audiogram. What level of deafness do you think this child or young person has? Is it the same in both ears or different? Now look at this audiogram. Are both ears similar or different? Which ear has the better hearing? What level or levels of deafness do the ears have? Lastly, look at this audiogram. Which type of sounds will this child or young person struggle to hear most? Low or high pitch sounds? Can you identify any particular sounds that this child may struggle to hear? Remember, you are allowed to look back at the pictorial audiogram, and the answers will follow shortly in our next slide. So, let's find out if you were right. The first example is fairly clear. This child or young person has a profound hearing loss in both ears. The second one, the second audiogram, is showing a unilateral or one-sided hearing loss with normal hearing in the right and a moderate level of deafness overall on the left. The final audiogram, the third one, is a little more tricky. If you take an average of the points, it works out as a very similar level to the first audiogram. So the child would be described as having a moderate hearing loss. But would this label give you an accurate idea of what the young person can and cannot hear? The answer is no, as the child or young person has better hearing in the low frequencies or pitches, but will struggle to hear higher pitch sounds such as st, f. If you look back at the speech banana, that green shaded area shown earlier. You will need further information which you can get from your teacher of the deaf to know more about the level of hearing the child you are working with and what level that is. It often helps to draw the child's audiogram onto one of those pictorial audiograms so that you can clearly understand which speech sounds or everyday sounds this child is or is not going to be able to access earlier. Particularly as you need to know, as this may influence the work that you're doing with that child. Always talk to your teacher of the deaf. Make sure you ask them plenty of questions. They'll be happy to answer them. So, just to make that point again, we would say it is always a good idea to talk to your teacher of the deaf, the teacher of the deaf that has been allocated to the child you work with, as they will be able to talk you through the audiogram for that child. They should also be able to give you further information on how long the child has had their hearing loss. Were they born with it? Did it happen later in life? As this will influence the impact that this has had on their speech development. The teacher of the deaf should also be able to give you some clues and pointers on the impact the child's deafness is likely to have on listening in the classroom, give you advice and guidance on deaf awareness and using their hearing aid technology, hearing aids, cochlear implants, whatever that may be. And they will be able to answer any other questions you may have. We must stress being able to hear a sound is only the first step. It may be that the child you're working with will take some time to learn to listen and to understand what sounds or words mean. This is where you will come in. So, on this slide are some activities for you to try to revisit and to consolidate what you have learned today. Can you explain the process of hearing to someone else, somebody in your family or a colleague, and or draw them a basic diagram of the ear? Secondly, can you remember three speech sounds that are quiet and high-pitched that might be difficult to hear? Thirdly, would you like to try wearing earplugs for a period of time? Try having a conversation with somebody whilst you're wearing them. Or if you're feeling really brave, wear them for a whole day and be in a classroom. You'll soon find out what a challenge it can be to have any level of hearing loss. Lastly, if you want more resources that explain how hearing works and different types of deafness, you may want to follow one or both of the links above. The top link, the National Deaf Children's Society, has links to many publications and resources that families and professionals find very useful. It has its own search engine on the website, and you can find out more about deafness and hearing loss and all other aspects to do with deaf education. The MADEL link, the bottom link, gives you a link to more information and diagrams and video animation about how hearing works. Thank you for your time, and you may also now wish to look at one of our other training modules available on the local offer.